This is Scotland, land of rugged mountains, sparkling lochs, and heather-clad hills. The crew have worked with several of Scotland's leading conservationists who are looking to restore key habitats with their very own hands. Wild animals and people are finding a way to live together, for this is a wild country on the cusp of change. A land where animals and plants are fighting to reclaim their place in the natural order. This is Scotland, the new wild. Our country has a vast and varied coastline, surrounded by nearly 800 islands. While only 93 are inhabited by people, these beautiful and remote places are a haven for some of the most spectacular wildlife in our nation. South on the Island of Rum, the rugged peaks offer a dramatic backdrop for the 1,000 red deer who live here. Scientists have been studying the red deer of Kilmore for over 50 years. This island is a special place for deer. The genetic information gathered here has helped inform the management of red deer populations across Europe. Autumn is rutting season, a crucial period for field worker Ali Morris.
It's one of our busiest times of year, and you just never know what's going to be happening at this time of year, so it's pretty exciting.
The Red Deer Project began in 1971, making it one of the longest-running mammal studies in the world. The deer within the glen are tagged to make them easier to identify.
The reason we can follow them through their lives is that they're hefted. That means they kind of live and grow up in the areas that their mothers were born in. So that's how we can follow down through the generations. So we've noticed that there's a difference in the timing of events throughout the year. So, for example, our calving season has become earlier, and that's come forward 12 days since the 1980s. And this is thought to be as a result of warmer climate during the summer.
Earlier calves also mean an earlier rut. Studying it requires a patient approach.
We go from baking hot to freezing cold and soaking wet quite often on a daily basis, but at the moment we're enjoying a little nice spell of almost sunshine. Oh, fight! So we've got Glariola 09 on the, oh well, being pushed up the hill and now back down it. Oh, I'm going over. Oh, somebody's broken an antler. That's Glariola 09's antler broken. Wisdom 11 has won. That was amazing. Can even see the antler on the ground there now. Poor old man. He'll be feeling really weird, not knowing what way to quite balance his head.
Ali sets off to carefully retrieve the antler.
That is a catastrophic break, and his rut's done for this year. It is a real privilege to be able to get up close and personal with these animals throughout their lives, and I've seen several generations of animals through my career here. From a purely observational point of view, it's a real privilege.
One of Scotland's most ambitious marine restoration projects is currently underway here in Loch Craignish in Argyll. Local charity Seawilding are replenishing some of the loch's seagrass meadows with their very own hands. Will Gowdy is the project manager of this pioneering scheme.
This season we're trying to harvest about 125,000 seeds is the target, and then hoping to increase that year on year.
Absolutely fantastic when you're in the water working with the seagrass. The environment is just wonderful, and it's just so peaceful. We're interested in restoring seagrass because it's a very important habitat for many species. It supports a huge amount of biodiversity, and it creates these three-dimensional habitats which create a haven for young juvenile fish and other marine life. And it also sequesters carbon as well and locks it away into the sediments.
The flowering stems and seeds are brought back on shore and placed in tanks. After a few months maturing, they can start to be separated. Preparing the seeds for planting is a team effort.
We have lots and lots of volunteers who come out from the community to help us with the seagrass harvesting and the processing of the seeds as well. So far we've planted about 350,000 seeds. We think we've got about 5 hectares of seagrass meadow in the loch here. So get a huge amount of satisfaction from doing this work. It's just really nice to know that we're actually making a difference. We have enough remnant populations of seagrass around Scotland that which potentially can be restored. So we're hopeful that in decades to come, we'll get back to where we once were.
The Highlands and Islands may be the most famous part of Scotland, but it's here in the Lowlands that our nation's character really comes to the fore. Home to more than 5 million people, it's a landscape of towns and cities, farms, and fragmented forests. You're never far away from humanity here, and wildlife has often been pushed to the fringes. But throughout the Lowlands, wild spaces are re-emerging. Beavers were absent from Scotland for hundreds of years. But now there are at least 1,000 of these industrious mammals living here. In 2021, Tom Bowser became the first person to be legally allowed to translocate beavers onto his land.
We decided to try and bring beavers here because they were being killed in huge numbers in other parts of Scotland. We know that they bring significant benefits for biodiversity, and we really thought in an environmental crisis it was such a waste that they were being killed when better options were there. I'll show you some of the things that the beavers have been working on. We've got a couple of trees here they've been gnawing in the last couple of nights. By gnawing these trees, they get access to a lot of the branches higher up that they couldn't reach otherwise. Bring that down to ground level, they'll be able to gnaw away on the branches and use them to shore up the dam. So beavers do two main things. They impound water and they gnaw wood, and these two things bring in all sorts of invertebrate life to areas. Perhaps you have more things coming and wanting to feed on them, so birds, bats, fish, all these things just get a huge boost. So the most interesting thing of all that the beavers did this year is how they managed to modify the pond to give themselves canals that they could travel safely along. And in doing so, while all the other waterways around here were drying up, they kept water in this pond and kept thousands of species alive.
Beavers re-channeling waterways can cause floods on some farmers' land.
There is a lot of controversy around beavers because of the way that they have come back via a series of either accidental or unauthorised releases. So a lot of farmers, I think, feel that the animals have been foisted upon them. The problem really comes down to the fact that 80% of Scotland's land mass is farmed. So ultimately, wildlife has to be somewhere, and it's going to be on someone's land. Beavers offer huge, huge benefits to the environment. So I hope that we can find a way that we can coexist with these animals, because they're not going away now that they're back.
The Lowlands are an intensely managed place. 75% of Scotland's landscape is utilised for agriculture. And most of it can be found here, dissected by a host of great rivers. The mightiest of which is the Tay. flowing for over 190 kilometres through glens, farmland and cities. This is one of the lowlands' most precious habitats, the Tay Reedbeds, home to the rare bearded tit, which only started to arrive here in the 1990s. It's thanks to the work of the Tay Ringing Group that these birds were discovered.
I've got a reed bunting here. I'll get it, it's high up. There he is. Okay.
These reed beds are a place head ringer Steve Moyes knows well.
I've been coming down here since 1984. It's absolutely unique, and there's nowhere else like it. And it probably has more birds going through it in a year than any other site in Scotland.
Ringing birds provides vital information on their lifespan, breeding success and movements. The birds are trapped in specialist mist nets, which cause them no harm.
We put rings on everything we catch, but the target species is the bearded tits. They're very prolific breeders. They can have 3 broods a year and they can have up to 6 chicks. So a pair can rear 18 young in a year.
Handling the birds takes skill to master and requires a special license.
We're doing this in our spare time. So it's important that you're coming down and doing work that's of value, and that's why I enjoy doing it.
3, 2, 1, go.
Lovely.
The hills and glens of the Highlands are what most people imagine when they think of Scotland. This is an ancient place, created by seismic continental collisions 400 million years ago. But the Highlands are not quite what they seem. Over centuries, much of this land has been cultivated, moulded by humans to suit our needs. Wildlife has been pushed to the brink. But all that could be changing. It's the dawn of the new wild in the Highlands. Throughout the series, the crew have worked with several of Scotland's leading conservationists.
Come on, eh?
Such as bird of prey specialist Dave Anderson.
I've been lucky enough to work with raptors nearly all my working life, so over 4 decades. I know I don't look that old, but I am.
So the golden eagle is a really important indicator species.
Everything else falls below them. So if golden eagles are doing well, then you would expect everything else to be falling into place and doing well.
Good to go.
Today, Dave is trying to ring and satellite tag a golden eagle chick.
Each eagle is like us. They're really individual. Some of them are very aggressive and some of them are very placid. So you really don't know what you're going to get until you get into the nest.
Satellite tagging has transformed our knowledge of the golden eagle.
It's really opened up our eyes to how they use the landscape, how far they travel, and where they travel from where they're born to where they eventually settle.
Well, how are you?
Now, this bird is between 7 and 8 weeks old, and all these little bits of chick down that it's still got will all start dropping off within the next week to 10 days.
Dave rings the bird so it can be identified later in life.
There you go, there's G19. So after ringing the bird, what we do is we take a few measurements. And then we look at the eyes. And this eye is really, really nice. You can see the protective filament coming across its eye. And then if you look at this eye, it's got really cloudy. And this bird's probably blind in this eye. Although it might inhibit the bird, they're perfectly capable of living with one eye. But because this bird is blind in this eye, I feel like it's got enough going on and I'm not going to put a satellite tag on it.
And here in the central highlands, the birds are doing actually really well. Every day you see an eagle is a great day, and I've been really lucky. I've seen golden eagles many, many times, and it's a sight I'll never get sick of.
Further north in the highlands sits the vast Mar Lodge estate, home to many special species. It's owned by the National Trust for Scotland, who are looking to restore key habitats. Shaila Rao is the Trust's conservation manager.
I think it's quite exciting now in Scotland, where there's much more of a vision for kind of landscape scale restoration.
Central to the Trust's long-term vision is the restoration of their peatlands.
This is a nice little corner that shows the sort of erosion that's going on of the peat. And you can see the water flowing down here and it undercuts the bank, and then we get these peat bergs. All that exposed peat is emitting carbon.
Healthy peat bogs act as huge carbon sinks, trapping carbon deep within them.
So the guys here today, they're putting in a wooden dam, and it holds the water back and rewets the peat, which prevents oxidation of the carbon.
Another type of restoration is taking place much higher up. Shaila and some planters are trying to restore a habitat almost entirely missing from the highlands, mountain woodland.
There's many species that would live and occupy the montane woodland habitat. So by recreating it, we're creating much better habitat.
So far, over 9,000 willow trees have been planted.
The reality of it is that landscape and woodlands and habitats are working at much larger timescales than our individual lifetimes. So I personally probably won't see the benefit of the work that we're doing here. But what we like to think is that we're creating a much healthier, robust and climate resilient habitat here that will be there for, you know, our grandchildren and generations beyond that.
In our fragile world, full of conflict and strife, wild animals need places to thrive. These ancient lands have seen change before, and there is hope. We're moving towards a greater understanding of just how important the natural world is. It's known that enjoying wild places and living alongside these magnificent species is good for our health, both mental and physical. And the change in mindset of millions of people can and will make a difference. Here, in Scotland's great new wild.